It is a huge honor for me today to be interviewing a personal friend of mine and buddy that goes way back in the day, Mary Beth Bajornas, who is basically, in my opinion of you, what your killer insight was is it takes 8 years to become a dentist. It takes 4 years to become a hygienist. My dental assistants all went to 1 year of a dental assisting school, Apollo College, what have you. And these front desk people, they're more times than not just hired off the street. They don't go to a formal training. They're not formally trained how to answer the phone. They don't see it like that. And the dentist is so just so obsessed with how to do a root canal. And I'm guilty of that too. I mean, I could watch 40 hours of bone grafting. And then you say to them, well, how do you enter a patient on dentrix? They're like, I don't know. We just hired a new receptionist. What is she supposed to do? I don't know, figure it out. Didn't she have dental experience or, you know? And you keyed in onto this that there's a lot of weak areas up front. And after hours phone answering, I mean, so I want to start with, in case there's someone living under a rock who doesn't know all about you and dental support specialties, because really you couldn't be on social media or Facebook or whatever and not know who the heck you are. You're a legend in my mind. So to tell them what dental support specialties is and how did you fall into this? How did you and your husband, Joe, why did you get into dental support specialties?
We got into it based out of, we had our youngest daughter 3.5 months early. And at that point, I was a business manager for a growing dental practice. I quit my job to be her, my daughter's therapies became my full-time job at that time. And, you know, I just wanted to find something that I could do at home to help buy groceries. So I had stayed in contact with Dr. Ron Arndt, the dental coach. And he had called me out of the blue, and he was like, hey, I got an office in Michigan. I think you might be able to help. And the idea was born from there, and I did everything virtual, and we've just grown through social media from that point, and that was 8 years ago.
So my listener is probably 80% of the times on iTunes. They're multitasking. They're driving to work right now. They could be on a treadmill or washing their car, but most of this is commute stuff. And what's amazing is you think of a commute as like living in LA, but almost everybody I talk to, it's like rural. It's like they live on a little farm ranch and they got a 70-mile drive every day to the office. So I'm driving to work. And you know what this dentist thinks? She's thinking, oh my God, my first patient is this or that or extraction or root canal or whatever. Tell them what they don't know about their front desk.
And what
you do and what your core company specialty in is and how you help that.
What our specialty is we become an extension of our practices. So we answer the phones, we schedule the appointments, we answer account questions and do everything insurance. So basically whatever an admin person does, we do.
Now, are you doing do you focus on after hours or is this augmenting the phone rolls over during hours?
This is the majority of our support is during hours. Most offices, as you know, are closed 1 or 2 days a week. A lot of offices take, you know, 6, 7, 8 weeks off a year. And we just make sure that we slip in. We're very seamless with our support. The patients have no idea that we're not sitting in that office. And we keep the production being scheduled and the connections with the patients being handled. And we just really try to tap into any opportunity that comes our way.
Do you get a lot of complaints about, I couldn't understand that lady from Ohio. Her accent was too thick.
No. And you know,
really?
The funny thing is we have an office in South Dakota and it was the first time in 8 years that I had somebody say, now, darling, where's your accent from? And I was like, I don't have an accent. But she knew I was from Ohio when I told her, so.
That was funny, a little piece of American history. The big ABC, NBC, CBS, when they were hiring all those anchors, they wanted the most neutral accent, and they were actually all hired from Nebraska, including Johnny Carson. They thought that was the most understood accent in America was Nebraska.
Yeah, it's crazy.
So the data I read, and you know, a lot of dentists, well, humans in general, they say things, but they don't have data to support it. But of the rare instances of the data I've seen, I hear that 50% of incoming calls to a dental office hit an answering machine.
Yes.
Do you agree with that number or disagree with that number?
I agree with that number. And of course, you know, there's some practices that we've contacted that don't even have voicemail or answering machines. They just ring incessantly when they're not in the office. So I do agree with that. And I'm certainly not saying that the front desk aren't doing their job. But there are times where they're so busy taking care of the in-house patients. You know, you have to decide on the fly, am I going to catch that phone? Am I taking care of this insurance? Am I on the phone with an insurance company? Am I presenting this treatment plan? So that's kind of where we jump in and absorb all those behind-the-scenes tasks.
So your business, is it mostly a rollover? Like, are you like the third line to where if someone's on line one, someone's on line two, and the phone rings, it rolls over to you? Is that your business or?
No.
Tell these dentists what your primary bit. What is your core competency? How much you charge? How does it actually work?
Sure.
Because I'm extremely intrigued with what you do because I went back to school and got an MBA at Arizona State University, and all my friends are dentists. I've been doing this 28 years, and there's only one thing dentists want to talk about, and that's dentistry. And right now, the buzzwords are surgical guides, CBCT. You can go on a six-hour bike ride with two other dentists and not even get off bone grafting. So, you know, they don't ever think about anything that you do.
Yes.
Everything you do, they don't want to think about. So tell them. So right now you got them for an hour. They're in their car. What do you do? Why do you, tell this dentist why he needs you. And then get to the elephant in the room. Like, what does this cost? How does this, and why is it a return on investment to this dentist?
We maximize their production. I mean, we are not an answering service in any way, shape, or form. We actually work as if we're sitting in the office. Myself and my entire team, we all have dental experience, so we're very proactive. I mean, if somebody's calling to schedule an appointment, when we're on the phone with them, we're looking, is there anybody else in the family due? Do they have any undone treatment that we could possibly schedule? If they're trying to cancel an appointment, we're making sure that we keep that appointment somewhere on the schedule. So, you know, our proactivity shows in the amount of production that we scheduled. Last month, we scheduled for our practices $277,000. So there's the proof in the pudding, as far as what we're able to do. You know, that's a lot of production that otherwise might have been missed.
That is amazing. So that's the return on investment. So they're paying you and you're putting patients in the chair.
Yes.
So how does it work? You're not an answering service. So,
no.
I mean, how does this work when so I'm a dentist, I'm driving in my car. I got four operatories. I got, you know, how does this work? I call you to do what? Are you the first person to answer the phone, the second? How does it work?
Normally, we are the first person to answer the phone, and we answer the phones as if we're sitting in that practice.
Why would a dentist want you to answer the phone instead of just hiring someone to answer the phone? What is the advantage of having you answer the phone?
I think one of the biggest problems that dentists across the United States are having right now are finding really great front desk people. Who come with a great attitude, a perky attitude.
Good.
They know what they're doing and know how to make the connections with the patients. I think that's one of the things that we do best, and we have patients who go in every single one of our practices and ask for us by name. So
I got to tell you, I've been in 50 countries, and I don't like to buy shoes and jewelry and, you know, I like shop. I just love to walk in dental offices. And I've walked in dental offices, and it doesn't matter. I mean, I've been in thousands of dental offices. 90% of the time, you walk in the office, and there's either a window and a sign-in chart, or they open the window and hand you a clipboard. I mean, they don't even look at you in the eye. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's just I've always said it's the weakest link in the dental chain. And then you go back to the dentist. You say, "Hey, hey, if I was a genie, if I was a genie, and you had one wish, what would it be?" Had a bone graft. You know what I mean? I mean, that's what they'd wish for. And I mean, it's just it's crazy.
Well, you don't know what you don't know, you know. And you know, I have a blog, and one of the things I'm always asking the doctors to do is call your own office from a completely different phone and listen to how your phone is answered. You know, it's so important to make those connections. And one of the things that I really believe is to a patient just walking down the street, a dentist is a dentist. You know, do you take my insurance? That's what their primary concern is. The one thing that will always set a practice apart from the rest is the customer service, how nice they were. I may be a little bit more expensive, but by gosh, you can bet your bippy they're going to remember my name and how I bent over backwards to help them.
So the dentist only knows her office. So she only knows her, she's using Dentrix by Henry Schein or Eaglesoft by Pat. Give them the breakdown of what percent or what computer systems and which ones do you work with and do you like any more than other? What is, you know, because we just had 5,000 dental graduates walk out of school. If someone was sitting down to buy a management information system, what should they be thinking about? What ones do you like? Find the data fast, quick to do what you do.
You know,
do you have any favorites?
I myself do. I've always been a Dentrix girl, but we know about 14 different softwares now. It seems that most of the new dentists coming out now are going with Open Dental.
Right, right.
It just seems to be that there seems to be a really big influx of Open Dental clients coming
and
on.
You know,
they're newer dentists.
You know why I think that is? I think it's Dental Town. Oh, okay. Well, you said money. Okay. Well, okay. Well, let's hear your voice because it's not a it's not a big bulk purchase.
No, it's not.
Go through. What would it cost me to buy Dentrix or Eaglesoft versus Open Dental?
You know what? I don't know the pricings on Dentrix and Open Dental. I know that I hear the feedback from our clients as far as the updates, and you have to be registered for the update packages and everything else. With Open Dental, I think they just pay monthly, and
right.
It's a very, very user-friendly program. Again, you know, once you know so many softwares, you can pretty much get any software to do what you need it to do. Mac Practice, to me, is a lot of fun. You know,
is that because your personal PC is a Mac?
No, I'm a PC person all the way.
But you like Mac.
It's fun. It is. I don't know. It's just different, but it's they all have their own bells and whistles. They really, really do. And like I said, all the new practices coming out and coming on board with us, we've seen a real big increase in the Open Dental.
So narrow it down to this kid that just walked out of school. You work with 14 systems. What would be your top three choices to do what you do?
Dentrix, Eaglesoft, and Open Dental.
Okay. And of those, on Dental Town, in my opinion, my personal opinion, it seems like the Open Dental people are just raving fans. It seems like if someone starts to throw out about Open Dental, they're just talking about how rockin' hot cool it is.
Yeah, it's simple. It's user-friendly. I mean, yeah. It's very easy to navigate. So
you know what if I kicked over a genie, one wish in dentistry, you know what it would be?
What?
Well, that Open Dental guy, the founder, is a dentist. And his brother's running it. I want them to add an accounting package to it so that the staff all clocked in and clocked off so that at the end of the day can say, okay, you guys did $6,000 and you made $882, you know. And, you know, I want it so that when the receptionist schedules an hour for an MOD filling on a PPO fee, that if they're going to lose money, it turns red and says, okay, in this 1 hour, your doc's going to lose $28. And then she moves it to 45 minutes, says, okay, now he makes 12. And then she moves it to a half hour, and it's like, now he's going to make $50. And I just think the fact that management information software has no accounting is literally the dumbest thing that happens in dentistry today.
Well,
not
only the accounting, but with what we do every day and all the different programs that we use, the smile reminders, the demand force, the practice management, I would love if Dentrix, Eaglesoft, and Open Dental would, like, merge and have a baby. and then wrap into that their own smile reminder into the practice management software, and the insurance verifications as well. I mean, like real-time full verifications, not
I think
just,
I think I just saw a pink pig riding a unicorn walk through that window.
Yeah, I know, place. Right?
I think I'd be killed by a meteorite 5 times before Shine or Patterson would pull that off. But again, I want to get back to my job is not I'm not trying to play dumb. I'm trying to guess questions.
Sure.
At 5,000, you know, my whole deal with Dentaltown from day one was with Dentaltown, no one has to be alone. So I'm trying to guess questions, and I want some guys saying, okay, so you're saying that if I sign up, if I go to dentalsupportspecialties.com and I sign up, that I have to have you answer the phone first. I mean, I already have a receptionist. So is that your only program where you answer first? What if I already have a receptionist? I'm in business. I got a girl up front. She's been with me 8 years, but I know people are going to voicemail. I know she's overloaded, and I she needs help. What would you say to that, Dennis?
Our support is completely customized to each one of our practices. So we are reserved in blocks of time. That's how we're paid. We're in blocks of hourly time. So if you want to reserve us for 4 hours of support, you tell me exactly what you want me to do in that 4 hours. It can be answering rollover calls, and when the phone's not ringing, make some recare calls, undone treatment calls, post-op calls, you know, work on submitting the insurance claims with the attachments, insurance recovery. You know, we've had a really large increase in the insurance recovery processes lately. So it's all customized to what specifically fits their practice. And what we do at our onboarding is I kind of pick the doctor's brain to find out where would we be the best support system for you.
And how does that, if that dentist wants to talk to you, how does that dentist talk to you?
He just
email, phone call, what would you recommend?
He can call our office here directly. He can email
what's
me.
Number? What's a number? What's the email?
330-639-1333. And my email is just marybeth@dentalsupportspecialties.com.
Okay, you ended about this insurance recovery. Explain mm-hmm. that to someone. Because Mary Beth, you have to really dumb it down when you're talking about dentists who want to do root canals about, I mean, what percent of dentists do you think could not go into their Dentrix or Eaglesoft and submit an insurance claim?
Probably not a lot.
The answer is all of them could not. If you found a doctor that could, he too would be a unicorn. So you just threw out a big term out there about insurance recovery, and that just flew right over her or his head. So go through that.
Well, it's the insurance aging. It's the insurance claims that haven't been paid that are sitting in a bucket or on a report instead of that cash being in your pocket. So what we do, we go through, we focus on the oldest claims first. We contact the insurance companies. We want to know, why hasn't this claim been paid? Has it been received? What do we need to do to get that claim paid and closed?
And what would be a red flag for this dentist driving to work that he had? What report could this dentist run on Dentrix or Eaglesoft or Open Dental when he got to work or could get to work? He's going to pull up to work in 35 minutes and say, can you run this report? I'm going to say, what would it be? An insurance aging report?
Yes. Yes.
And then what would be on that report that would make you think, yeah, you should call me?
Well, if you have $100,000 sitting in on a report in a 90-day bucket, that's a challenge.
So you're talking about over 90 or just over 30? Would
you
age
what?
That 30, 60, 90?
Yes. I always look at the 60, 90. And if
there should be nothing in your over 30, over 60, over 90. I mean, there shouldn't be a dollar in there.
The over 30,
or is that not right?
The over 30, there usually will be something hanging out. I mean, the insurance companies have made it a nightmare to get some of these claims processed. They really have. But the 60 and 90 day bucket, those should be clean. They should just be clean, because if they're not, that's money that's not sitting in your pocket. You know, we've had some docs that have not, like you said, ran the report, and they've had over $1 million sitting on an aging report.
And just think, if that doctor collected that $1 million, he could finally afford that divorce he's been wanting for 10 years. Yeah. You say, I finally have the money to cash out. So this, how could this not be a return on investment if you had, what would be that the average person calling you to say, Mary Beth, will you clean up my over 30, over 60, over 90? How much money would be sitting in there, and what kind of return on investment would that be for the doctor?
You know what, with the average amount that each office has, it varies. I mean, there's some offices that'll call, a doc will call and be like, oh my gosh, I think I have a problem, and they only have $9,000. You know, it's like, that's nothing. You know what I mean? There's some offices, like I said, that have had over $1 million, and it's like, oh, that's a problem. So when it comes to the time needed to be able to clean up those claims, it all depends on how much is sitting in those buckets.
You know what I like about Harvard Business Review is the most is just the case studies, because I just really like the stories. Here's the name of the company. Here's their product. And what was wrong? What's wrong? Talk to us. Tell us some cases of clients you've had, what it looks like. I'm trying to get this dentist driving his car to see if this kind of matches their office. Tell some cases that when these dentists are dumped in your lap, what the case looked like and what did you do for them?
A lot of the insurance recovery processes, you know, they can take, you know, the $1 million one probably took us about 8 months to get that stabilized. I mean, we had the buckets down to about 10 grand by the time we were done. There's some offices that they call us for recare projects. You know, they have no recare system in place. Their hygiene schedule's empty. They don't understand why. You know, one of our offices, when they hired us, nicest doc, I ran the recare report in his EagleSoft, and the recall whiz hadn't been run in 3 years.
Yeah.
So.
But could he bone graft?
I think he could.
Oh yeah, it's funny that they want to meet you. There were 275 dental implant companies at Cologne. And every dentist wants to talk about every slightly different modification of a titanium implant. And then you go up to them and you say, by the way, how many new patients did you get last month? No idea. What is your recall system? Clueless. What's your over 30, 60, 90? No idea. What's your labor? I don't know. I mean, and then if they ever – and I want to make this absolutely clear to dentists. A lot of times dentists go home from study clubs and they feel bad because the guy next to him says, well, my overhead's 50%. Dude, when a dentist tells you their numbers, it's never correct. I've never heard a dentist tell me their correct number. Like, they'll say, well, my labor is 20%. Does that include FICA matching? What? Uniforms? Continue ed? I mean, what? You know, you just – and then you'll go in their office and they'll say, well, what's your overhead? 60, 65%. And then you go in there and it's 82. And you're like, how did you – why did you say 65? And say, well, you know, 60, 65, 80, 82. You know, I mean, they don't know any of these numbers. And that's why half of the dentists get embezzled from, is because they can't even go up to their dentrix and they don't. They got the same girl getting the checks, depositing the checks, paying checks, sitting there stealing money, and then going in and cleaning up the records. And I mean, crazy. So what other service? You said you talked a lot about insurance count recovery. You talked about recall. What is a good recall system? You've been in this field 20 plus years. What recall system do you like? Do you like the patient sign the card and then mails it to themselves? Do you like 2 weeks confirming a night before? What do you recommend? And if someone really hasn't worked their recall in several years and is driving to work right now, and think maybe I should call Mary Beth to go through my charts and find and reactivate my hygiene. What recall system do you like?
You know, we always start out with phone calls, personal connections. I just think keeping those personal connections are so priceless. You know, we all use our own language here. One of the ways that I can connect with patients really, really well, and I get away with saying is, you know, I'll call the patient, hey, this is Mary Beth from whatever office. Do you miss me? And what they always do is they laugh. That's exactly what they do. But it disarms them a little bit, you know, and then it opens up a great way for me to connect with them and say, I know we're not your favorite place to go, but come on. So phone calls are always best, but I like combining still the old fashioned archaic postcard system, and combining that with the smile reminders and the demand force. You know, there's a lot of offices that solely rely on those automated systems. And while it works great for some patients, there's some patients that it's too easy to ignore.
Okay, there's there's a lot of people listening to you right now. I bet 3,000 out of 5,000 have heard about smile reminders, demand force. What's the one that Fred Doyle at Future Donics has?
Patient activator.
They've seen these brand names. They know Nike, Budweiser, Kurz, but they don't really know what it does. Explain to them what those three things do.
Those are automated patient connection portals, basically. They'll text your patients. They'll send them emails. The patients have to opt in for what type of communication they prefer. It's a great way for – it's a great add-on for confirmations and the recare, and you can follow up with those as well. But, you know, as we all know, those of us who touch schedules every day, you're still going to have those patients that just can't click confirm, and you're still going to have to call them and confirm. You still have the patients that you can see on those systems when they've opened what you've sent them. You've sent them 8 emails, and they still haven't called to schedule their appointment. Well, you have to have systems in place to follow that up with personal phone calls and connections.
And I want to say, you know, you're supposed to treat other people like you want to be treated. It's funny because dentists are always complaining about no-shows and cancellations. Mm-hmm. And yesterday, just in one day, 3 dentist friends shared with me, oh, my God, I was swamped. In fact, I had a doctor's appointment at 2 and didn't even make it. I'm like, dude, did you call? Oh, no, I didn't even realize. I had an appointment at 10:30 and didn't even realize till 1. So dentist miss appointments. It reminds me back in the days of when Yellow Page advertising go, who would want a patient from someone that uses the Yellow Pages, and in the background you can see the wife using the Yellow Pages. You know what I mean? It's like, well, your own lover who you chose to reproduce, have offspring with, has got it in her hand right now, but you don't want that type of patient, but you married one that uses it. So besides, and I've never heard that insurance recovery. I always heard that called working the insurance 30-60-90.
Recovering those funds.
Recovering. You talked about recall. What other services?
Undone treatment calls.
Undone treatment. Mhm. And you have ways of measuring what you're doing, so a dentist could sit there. When you bill a dentist, do you say, you're giving me X dollars and I scheduled this many or I collected this? You give those kind of metrics?
Yes. At the end of every month, we send out our success reports that show, you know, how many incoming calls do we handle, how many new patients, how much production. You know, I mean, we break it down. We want to show them their value. And look, I know where our value comes to our clients, and that's from the money I put in your pocket or on your schedule or the efficiencies that we bring to your practice.
And I just want to say, I don't even know if I've ever said this. I think this is our 95th podcast. Right? I don't think I've ever said this. By the way, all my guests on my podcast, they're all free. There's no money change hands. I don't make a dime. I have no connection. Mary Beth didn't pay me $20 to plug her. I'm in search. All my podcasts are free. They're free to listeners. They're free to everything. There's no money tainting this system. I'm always in search of the best content. And I have to tell you, you have a rocking hot reputation. I mean, you couldn't throw a cat at a dental convention and not hit someone who thinks the world of you and thinks you've done good.
Thank you.
And that might be a big part because you're giving them a success report. We're actually saying, dude, look, this is what I did for you. Go ahead.
I was just going to say we hold ourselves accountable. I mean, we have our own internal goals that we want to strive to hit to make sure that we're exceeding our client expectations. And sometimes what we've noticed what happens is our clients become dependent on those reports. They want to see, okay, I'm paying you this. I want to know what you're doing. But yet what nobody does in the office is they don't hold their employees accountable to that same standard. Which I really, really think that offices need the systems and the protocols to make sure that the systems that you want for your practice are being completed. You know, post-op calls are one of the things that I don't think people do enough of. And it is such an amazing way to connect with those patients. You know, we've scheduled new patients off of post-op calls, you know? So it's just, you need to make sure.
Now, when you say a post-op call, you mean Dennis did a root canal or pulled a tooth on, mm-hmm. on Mrs. Jones. And you do the post-op calls on those?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And you like doing those night? What are your hours? You like doing those the next day? What are your hours, by the way?
We are Monday through Thursday, 8 to 6 Eastern Standard Time, and Fridays, 8 to 5 Eastern Standard Time. And we have just now recently started extending our hours to accommodate some West Coast clients. So there's some of those days that we are available till 7 or 8 Eastern Standard Time to accommodate some other needs. With the post-op calls, we usually do those the next day. And we just touch base with the patient and ask them how well they're getting along after their visit with Dr. Ferran. Do they have any questions for me? And, you know, just make those connections. And there's so many patients that are like, wow, thank you so much for calling me. That was really nice. So.
Nice. So Mary Beth, I want to talk to you another angle. The dentist lives in their own office. They only know their office. They walk out of dental school. Maybe they did a residency in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, or a veterans deal. And they only see their office. You see offices. You see lots of offices for years and years and decades and decades. What do you think the doctor I call it, you know, the dentist practices inside his little bubble. You know, he's inside his little bubble, mm-hmm. and he only knows what he knows. He doesn't know what he doesn't know. What is the low-hanging fruit, do you think? What would you say to these dentists who say, Mary Jo, you know, I'm in a small, my economy's not good in my area. We've lost some factories. We've lost some jobs. My office has been flat for 10 years. It's really, you know, I'm not living where all the money is, like in Ohio. I'm out here and, you know, I'm not in the gold mines of Ohio. I'm in a flat, tough economy. I'm in a city that's not going anywhere. It's been flat for a decade. What do you think the low-hanging fruit is? From a practice management perspective, what are the people doing better, doing more of, than the people doing worse?
Consistent systems. Consistent is the key. I mean, they have their systems. They're working them exactly the same consistently, and they're monitoring their results. And if they don't see the results that they're expected, then they make shifts. They allow the room for the change. But consistency is so crucial. You know, we see a lot of offices that will hire a dental consultant to come in, and, you know, the dental consultant has fabulous ideas and great tips for them that would probably work. And they say, okay, now implement those, catch you later. Well, what happens is 9 times out of 10, within 4 weeks, that office is fallen right back to their old ways. There's been no accountability. There's been nobody kind of cracking the whip saying, that's not how we're doing it anymore. And so they fall back to their old ways and their comfort zones, and then they wonder why they paid all this money for a consultant and they didn't get anything out of it. So what we do is we work those systems, you know, because I'm not a consultant, but you're right. We see practices, you know, we're in 44 states, we're up in Canada, we kind of see how the systems roll, and we see the difference between the practices that are booming and doing $3 million a year with one doc and the opposite end of that. And I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt, it is the consistency in the systems.
And what would you say, you deal with dentists in 44 states, what would you say to all the dentists in Colorado? Just quit smoking pot? You know,
maybe smoke some more? I don't know.
It's not 420. It's not 420. Maybe they should open up at 6, so at 420. But consistent systems. And when you say the word systems, this dentist is thinking of finding an MB2 and a molar root canal. What systems are you talking about?
For everything. You have to have a recall system. You have to have a follow-up system for undone treatment. You know, there's so many practices when a patient was in for a cleaning, the doctor recommended a crown, patient went up to the front desk and is like, oh yeah, I'm in a hurry. I got to check my schedule. I'll call you back. And then you don't see him again for 6 months. You have to have systems in place to be able to reach out to those patients, because if you don't, you won't see them again unless they become unless they break the tooth or until their next recare visit. So, you know, systems for the insurance recovery follow-up, those reports should be being processed every 2 weeks minimum to make sure that the 60-day buckets are clean. You want to have systems for follow-up on referrals, you know, for offices that you refer patients out. You know, did you refer somebody to a periodontist and, like, you haven't seen that patient again in 8 months? You know, you have to follow up with all of those systems to make sure, number one, that you're keeping the patient connections and relationships, but it's the best way to keep your production flowing and your schedule full.
I want to say two things on referrals since you brought that up. Number one, on referrals, I will not refer to a specialist who doesn't make sure his front desk and my front desk get the treatment plan from my office over there, because I don't want to send four wisdom teeth to an oral surgeon who's not going to sit there and get his treatment plan so that a prominent oral surgeon walks through and says, by the way, Mary Beth, just make sure you know you have four cavities and you need to, after this, you need to go back and get those filled. Otherwise, you're going to be in here someday and I'm going to be pulling four more teeth. So are you aware you have those four cavities? Because if you're not, maybe we should be pulling eight teeth today and not four. And they come back and their eyes are this big. You were right about those cavities. Yeah. That oral surgeon, get back in here or he's pulling four more. So they got to see the treatment plan. And then the other thing is on endos, never send an endodontist a retreat if the endodontist can't place an implant. Because if your only tool is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Humans can rationalize anything. They're like, well, I gave it my best shot. Dude, you knew it didn't have a prayer's chance in hell. And you took $1,500 from her. And the only reason you did it is because you got a family to feed. And I only use endodontists and periodontists who can – I want a periodontist that can sit there and say, I'm not gonna screw around this tooth. I'm going to pull it and place an implant. So I want multiple hammers. But and then the other thing on the referrals is you got to recognize the humans that refer your patient. You have to recognize them somehow. How do you recommend recognizing them? Because you want to reward that behavior so they do it again.
Absolutely. A lot of our offices do the gift cards, you know, a mug with their practice name on it and a bouquet of flowers that's delivered to their work. I personally love that one because it's kind of advertising for you as well. Who doesn't like to receive something at work? And personal phone calls go a long way. You know, if the doc calls and says, hey, John, thank you so much for referring so-and-so to me. What a great guy. It goes a long way.
And the only thing I'll add to that is some dentists are men, and some men aren't very emotionally intuitive, and someone referred them like a big $50,000 implant case or whatever, so they freak out and they send someone like a dinner for two at a really nice restaurant. Mm-hmm. That creeps people out. They're sitting there eating a really nice steak dinner that might cost $100, and it's creepy. So the gist needs to be intuitive to the heart.
Yes.
A cup, candy. I'm a fat guy. I like food, nuts, gum, you know, a mug, something to say, oh, intrinsically, that was sweet. But when you whip out a $100 or $200 or $300 gift because it was a big $10,000 case, people feel dirty about that. They're like, am I referring people to a doctor to get surgery? I mean, I just, you know, so.
And even with the referrals, I also like making sure when I worked physically in an office, I made sure that for that whole week, I knew if anybody coming in had a birthday that week, the week before, the week after, I gave them a mug with a toothbrush and floss and a balloon tied to it. And again, it was just all about, I wanted people to leave with a smile on their face because of us. So I did those little things too.
You know, I love you know, humans are so complex. I'm convinced at 52 years old that I'm the only normal person on earth. I believe it to my heart. But you know, they say it on those TVs, you know, on the B2C, like getting a CD-ROM on an annuity. You know, no salesman will call you. You know, people are so confrontational, intolerant. They don't want a salesman coming in because they don't want the confrontation. They just would rather have no one. How does this shy introvert dentist who could have been a physicist or an electrical engineer, he doesn't have enough personality to become an accountant, and he's just curious if you could help, but he doesn't want any confrontation. He doesn't want to call and and all this. Do you, I mean, what is the consultation? I mean, do you like dive into their computer with like, how can this shy introvert geek dentist talk to the Mary Beth and find out if he has any of these issues with recall, undone treatment, insurance recovery? He doesn't even know what is over 3069. He has no idea if the undone treatment in his own charts is $10,000 or $100,000. How much do you think his undone treatment is? So the average guy, gal, listen to this, who's been practicing 10 years, what do you think the average undone treatment is?
Average probably just from January of this year, if it's a, you know, pretty solid practice, is probably upwards of $600,000 plus. I mean, people would be shocked when they run those reports.
I know, but they're not going to run the report. So I'm listening to you. I'm listening to you right now. I'm going to pull up to my work in 19 and a half minutes. How can I non-confrontationally call you? So how can I find out if you can do something for me? What would you recommend the doctor do?
Just call me and say, you know, a lot of times I'll have a doc call and say, you know what, I saw you wherever and I don't know how I could use you, so can you talk to me? And I just ask them questions. I mean, usually people call me because they're in pain somewhere or they know that things aren't the way that they want them to be. So it's my job to find out how I could best support them. And as we all know, I have the gift of gab and talking, so.
and blogging. I love your blogs. And that's another thing about the dentist. The dentist should go to dentalsupportspecialties.com just to sign up for the blogs, because if you want to go to work and you really do just want to do amazing dentistry, if that email was blogged to you, and you sign up for your email deal, you could forward that to your staff. And then tell the staff that tomorrow at the morning huddle, you know, that you got five people that you want Amy to summarize Mary Beth's blog. So for the morning huddle tomorrow, Amy, I want you to summarize this blog, and I want to make sure I'm doing that. I mean, how often do you blog?
You know, probably once a month. I mean, it's been falling a little bit behind because I've been so busy supporting clients. But I always have probably one idea a day from what I see of, okay, that's my next one. That's got to be my next blog. You know, just to touch on some of the things that, like you said, they aren't really aware of, but it does make a difference. So those are the things that I try to address.
How many blogs have you made?
I don't even know. I'm on WordPress, probably 80. I have no idea. Maybe not even that many.
Yeah, it could actually be a book. But anyway, your blogs are amazing. And in fact, you know what I wish you would do? You know what I always do? You know, when I saw I was going to podcast you yesterday, I was going to try to hit you up. But you got 80 blogs.
They're on Dental Town, too. I got them on Dental Town.
Yeah, and I've never read one of your blogs and didn't take my mind out for a run and learn something. I don't think I've ever read one of your blogs and not learned something. And I'm always forwarding to my team. But you've never, you know, some people like to listen to podcasts. Some people like to read blogs. You should make an online CE course on Dental Town that goes over all this stuff. You've been doing this for 20 years. You know, we put up 317 courses, and they just passed 500,000 views. It reminds me when I started lecturing. I mean, some people would, you know, you meet at a desk, and they'd say, oh, I read your book. And then the next one would say, oh, I watched your VCR tape. Another one would say, oh, I went to your lecture. But it was totally different markets.
Right.
Some were readers. Some were they had to see it live. They knew they could never commit to a book. They'd never read it, so they had to go to the lecture. Other people were just TV people. But it's all different markets. You should do an online CE market because I've got the data, and that's a different market than other markets. Some people just like the CE, and there's a huge market that – only will do the live, but if you took those 80 blogs, I bet you couldn't even do it in an hour. I bet it'd be a three-part series.
At least.
And what if it's at least, do it for, because you know what the dentist could do? The favorite musician in the world is Michael Jackson. My mom always says it's Fred Astaire, who's the old crooner from New York?
Frank Sinatra.
My mom will go to the grave thinking it's Frank Sinatra, and she doesn't realize nobody listens to Frank Sinatra in Africa, Asia, India, Brazil, Kathmandu, Nepal. And I've never been to one of those countries and not found someone jamming out to Michael Jackson, right, drinking a Coca-Cola. I mean, he's literally just beyond a legend. And his favorite song of mine is Man in the Mirror. And so you got to be, you got to be true to yourself. And if you don't like this stuff, you could create a course, or it's got to be in hour increments for staff meetings or whatever. Mm-hmm. But if it was one of a one or two or three part series, the easiest thing you do is make the rest of his office watch it. So he can sit there and say, you know, right, I'm really not into this, but I am into it enough to make you guys all do it.
Right.
You know what I mean? I mean, gosh, I mean, it's kind of like your wrestling coach. You know, they'd have you running bleachers for an hour, and you'd all be sitting there thinking, why did that fat, lazy ass run with us? You know, why is he sitting there with a Starbucks coffee in his hand? Why isn't he running bleachers? You know, he's the fattest guy in the whole gymnasium. And so if you're that lazy dentist who's just not interested in any of these systems, and I think that was amazing that I asked you, what is the key to success? What do the most successful dentists do that the more unsuccessful ones do less? And you said consistent systems. And, man, that consistent system, that's probably the most powerful two words that I've heard in dentistry in my lifetime. I mean, that's just it.
Mm-hmm.
That's just it. And it's funny because the really successful dentists are the ones that just – that there's the dentist sitting out there in a losing practice thinks there's some magic bullet. If I bought a CAD cam, if I bought a CBCT, if I bought a laser, if I just bought a magic bullet and kicked over a genie and a unicorn popped out, all my problems be solved. And what they don't realize is that success, just getting up and doing your daily grind. And Lori and I call it the daily 20-mile march. We just get up. Every day we march for 20 miles, and then we go to bed. And we get up and we do it again, and we've been doing it for 28 years. And then when people see you real high on the mountain, they go, how do you get up there? Just all day,
marching.
Every day, just kept doing consistent systems, getting systems. And what the dentists do is they learn something at a seminar. It's their new thing at the office. And then you come back 90 days later, and and it's gone. So how what's your advice on how to stay consistent? You think having a support person like you, you think you keep them consistent?
I do. I think that we're so consistent and systematic with what we do. Now, again, we customize what we do off of our practices, but we make it systematic. The other thing that I think not enough offices do, Howard, is make notes. I have one of my blogs about notes, and I'm telling you what, notes can make such a huge difference in successful scheduling. If somebody cancels an appointment because they had the flu, you know, so many offices just delete the appointment, which gives me panic attacks. That appointment needs to be sent to the unscheduled list with a detailed note, insert a dateline, patient canceled today, has the flu. Then that list needs to be worked consistently. Guess what? In 2 weeks, I can call that guy. I have the notes. I can say, how are you feeling? Are you ready to get this appointment rescheduled? Those little nuances of notes make a huge difference, and there's never enough notes anywhere. You know, how many times has somebody looked at a schedule and saw an emergency patient that got slapped in, and they have no, you know, the doctor's looking, he's scrambling, he has no idea why that patient's there.
You know, that's why in 1999 I went paperless. A lot of people thought I went paperless for a lot of other reasons. I've heard all kinds of reasons of why people think other people go paperless. I went paperless because from 87 when I opened till 98 when I went paperless, I kept telling my receptionist, every time a patient calls, you have to pull the chart. And at first they said the phone cords wouldn't reach. Then we got like 15-foot cords. And basically, long story short, we're not perfect at all. I'm not perfect. You know how many times someone would call and no one could find the chart? And then they were on hold and walking around the office. Have you seen Mary Beth's chart? Have you seen Mary Beth's chart? Have you seen? And finally I realized, you know what? You know, the only way I can get them to pull the chart is to get rid of the charts and make it all digital. Because I knew they could pull up Mary Beth's chart digital. But I knew that if they had to pull 25 charts, for some reason, someone's on hold, someone's checking out, they just don't have the time. Probably 5 out of 25 charts wouldn't get pulled. At least 1 out of 25 charts are lost for all time. You know what I mean? And
with the notes, it's always been my purpose, and it's what I constantly train my team on. all of our notes that we make for our clients, we want to make sure that they can pick up our conversation with the patient where we left off. And that's what we look for. And it's even that patient who left without scheduling the crown. Why did he leave without scheduling the crown? So when I follow up with him in 4 days, I can continue the conversation that he left with. You know, and it just, if he was going to check his schedule, I can call and make that connection. I know you were going to check your schedule. How does next Tuesday look? Or, you know, the funds, whatever. It's just continuing the conversations. So even at the next hygiene visit, the hygienist can look at those notes and pick up that conversation where it was left off.
And the other thing to remember out there in iTunes land is that the number one predictor of future behavior of any human is past behavior. And the bottom line is that I don't care if there's a billion people in Africa, a billion 200 million in India, a billion 300 million in China, doesn't matter. The most likely person to ever come back to your office and give you a dollar ever again is someone who's already been in there.
Yes.
And they'll have 5,000 charts, and all they want to do is put up billboards and radio and yes. Facebook and Twitter and Tweeter. And it's like, dude, Mary Beth saying you probably have $500,000 of treatment that's never been scheduled. People came in here for a cleaning and walked out and weren't scheduled to recall. Yeah, 5,000 charts. Think of that. If a hygienist worked 40 hours a week, 50 weeks a year, cleaning your teeth twice a year for an hour, she could only service 1,000 people. 40 hours a week times 50 weeks divided by 2 is 1,000 hours. So if you have 5,000 charts, where's your 5 full-time hygienists working 40 hours a week, 50 weeks a year? And I can't tell you how many times you'll walk into two offices. They both have 1,200 charts, and one office does twice of what the other office does. And they're in the same medical dental building. And the one doing half as much, you say, well, why does your office suck? Oh, because, you know, the factory shut down and Obamacare and Greek's going to default and all this stuff. And I'm like, well, really? Well, why is the other guy next door who's also short, fat, and bald, why does he do twice as much money as you with the same staff? Why is his overhead 45% and you're 68%? And they want to blame it on everything except the man in the mirror.
Yep. And it's the systems, and you just have to be nice. I mean, how many times, Howard, have you gone into an office and they really aren't nice?
Yeah.
You know?
Yep.
So.
People are so complex. So I've only got you for 8 more minutes. So I want to get to the dentist. I always like to talk about the things that no one wants to talk about. Price. What do you charge them? This dentist thing. How does Mary Beth charge me? How does this cost?
Hourly. It's hourly. You retain us hourly. And the actual hourly rate is dependent on how many hours you retain us for each month. One of the great things that we do is we do not make anybody sign a long-term contract. We have clients who go month to month. They'll use us this month to peak up their hygiene and then pause a month and then have us the next month. Some of our offices are longest standing.
So you don't have a long-term contract?
No, they can go month to month.
So you're saying you and your husband Joe are in an open relationship with no long-term contract. That's what I just heard. Is that what you just said?
No, I said with my clients.
I saw you had a wedding ring on, so how come Joe had to do a long-term contract, but your dental customers don't?
Because that's how I roll.
That's how you roll? So there's that's cool. That speaks volumes that you're not trying to use a big sales pitch, because the thing about contracts is the thing I don't like about contracts is they're going to sell you a big thing to get you to sign the dotted line. If there's no dotted line to sell, they're not going to sell you a big thing. And they're sitting there thinking, I want a long-term relationship. So that's a lot of trust up front for Mary Beth to say, I don't need a contract with you. I think you're going to value our service. I'm going to send you a success report, and you're going to see why this is a good thing. And I'm doing business in 44 states, including Colorado, where all of her clients are stoned. Do you have to read the reports to the dentist in Colorado?
No.
Really?
No.
You don't have to read it loud while they're eating Doritos.
No.
Okay. Just check.
With the contract thing, I know how I am, and you said it earlier in our conversation, you know, treat people the way you want to be treated. You know, contract to me is such an ugly word. You know, I want people to feel good about what we do back to us because they loved what we did. not because I hogtied him to some contract that didn't feel good, you know? So that's always been my premise. I don't like signing contracts. If I like what you do, I'll be back. So that's what our system is for that. And again, the pricing all depends on how many hours they retain us for. And the hourly retainer, like I said earlier, you retain us for blocks of time, and then we decipher together what we're going to accomplish. We have a priority task list that we give to our clients, and that is what we bang out. And then we give them a daily report showing everything that we've done.
That's truly amazing. And like I say, I can vouch for you and the fact that no money changes hands on any of my podcasts ever. These are all from the heart. To me, I love doing podcasts, like taking a friend, going to, to me, it's always like going to lunch with a friend. When's the last time we had dinner? It was
3 years ago.
3 years ago in Ohio.
In right? Cleveland, yep.
Yeah,
at Cleveland. The North Coast Spring Expo, I think.
Yeah, and I didn't get to eat dinner because Rick DePaul ate all my food. And he's just, that's the way he rolls. He ate his serving.
I got some good pictures of you both, though.
He ate his serving, and then he ate mine, so I'm still confused why I'm still fat. And since I didn't get dinner that night. But no, I think you're a bomb. I really do think it would be an amazing service to dentistry if you took your 80 amazing blogs and rolled them into a series. And don't try to fit it all in our make one. Whether it's one of and I'll tell you another tip for you guys making online seeing Dental Town. When they go to, like, say, endodontics, and there's like 8 guys put up a root canal course, but one guy put up a 3-part series, the guy that does a 3-part series gets all the views because they look at it, and the person who has a 3-part series, probably they just assume knows the most. It's kind of like they assume Toys R Us has more toys than Walmart, even though it's not really true. Walmart sells more toys than Toys R Us, but people just assume. So to take your time, do it once and right, because I think you have an amazing amount of amazing information that would serve dentistry so well. And the saddest thing about dentistry is the reason we became a dentist is not to learn dentrics. I mean, we didn't go to dental school for 8 years because we were interested in insurance. We went there because we wanted to try to do a root canal. We wanted to try to extract a tooth. So we, at the end of the day, I would rather pull 4 wisdom teeth than play 18 holes of golf. I really would. I would rather spend 3 hours trying to pull out a broken endophile than get a 3-hour massage mani-pedi ended with an ice cream cone. The coolest thing in the world to me is fixing teeth. And so my colleagues, you know, I got my MAGD. My colleagues want to work in the mouth. They don't want to work at a computer terminal. And they just don't know what they don't know. And I think you know as much or more than anyone I know. And so they can call you. And by the way, that number, you notice her number is 330-639. But notice the last, it's 1333 because she's half a devil. It's not 666. She's just half a devil. She's ends her number in 333. And you got to finish the story. You started with Alison, came home 3.5 months premature. So everybody's out there wondering, how is she doing? How is she doing now?
She is completely mainstreamed, and she's going into third grade. So we are blessed beyond belief. So.
Right on, Allison.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, Mary Beth, seriously, thank you for your being a townie for years, for your hundreds of posts. I think you have like 400 posts. Thank you for always emailing me your blogs over the years. I forward every single one of them to my team. Thank you so much for all that you've done for me personally, my dental office personally, Dental Town, Today's Dental. And like I say, if you're listening to this on your car, or you're pulling up to work and you're not sure, call Mary Beth and just have her poke around. What are you going to do? Go to GoTo meeting, or what are you having to do? Download?
We have our own portals through LogMeIn. So that's how I would remote in.
Oh, and I want to ask one more thing. Could you also, this dentist listening, could you also scout around and see if you have any red flags of embezzlement?
We have been asked to do that before, yes.
So there's 100 reasons. There's 100 reasons, caller. But again, Mary Beth, thank you again so much.
Well, thank you, Howard, thank you for everything you do for dentists. I've actually had 2 new dentists tell me that they built their practices based off of what they found on Dental Town. So what you provide to dentists is an amazing, amazing value and resource. And thank you. And thank you for having me today.
All right, and tell your hubby, Joe, I said hi.
Okay, will do.
All right, bye-bye.
Thanks, Howard. Bye-bye.